So, when the book Journey Home was to be published, at that time, I had already written a few books. And what's happening here? Okay. So, Maharaj Gaurang Prabhu actually at that time gave Maharaj's book to me for reading. And then he told Maharaj that, he's also a writer. And I gave him a book. So, Maharaj asked me, what are your thoughts about the book? So I was stunned by the sheer amount of adventures in that book. But I told Maharaj, what struck me very much was the tone of the book. So I said, Maharaj, you are not writing here as a teacher or acharya speaking to students or disciples. You are writing like a seeker sharing wisdom with other seekers. So Maharaj told me at that time that this is the tone that you need today if you want to reach to a Western audience. And India is also becoming Westernized increasingly. So if you can learn this tone, you can reach a large number of people. So that was about 2005 or 2006. So that's the time I started trying to understand what it means by the tone. Then when afterwards, I asked Maharaj, what inspired him to write this book? So Maharaj told me something which had not struck me at all when I read that book. It was, he said, this is my way to glorify Srila Prabhupada. Many of my god brothers and god sisters have written books, their memories of Prabhupada, and these are my memories of Prabhupada. This is my way of glorifying Prabhupada. Now, I thought about it at that time, then when I had asked Maharaj further that, there are so many things happening in this book that the book is about the glorification of Srila Prabhupada may not be evident to people. So Maharaj said, yes, and that is the strength. Then he spoke something, and now I'm using my words to explain this. See, there is exclusive glorification. Exclusive glorification means that is possible for those who have accepted Srila Prabhupada as their savior. We could say those who are insiders. And most of the books that are written for Srila Prabhupada's glorification are in this mood. So they are written by insiders for insiders. How wonderful Srila Prabhupada is. And it's almost as if there are no other spiritual teachers who exist. And if they exist, they are just, in today's world, they are just nothing. They are just to be dismissed. So now for those who have become insiders, this kind of glorification is is relishable. But a large number of people are not among the insiders. So how do we reach Srila Prabhupada to them? Take Srila Prabhupada to them. So the Maharaj practically meets in the journey home. In his life, he has met, and he reports in the journey home, he has met practically all the prominent spiritual teachers of the 1960s. And the fact that he says, after meeting all of them, he chose Srila Prabhupada. That means he's basically, by his actions, he's showing that for him, Prabhupada was the one who attracted him the most. Prabhupada had the most spiritual potency. So one doesn't have to say that Prabhupada is the greatest spiritual teacher. Let your actions speak louder than your words. So inclusive glorification means we don't have to dismiss other spiritual teachers in order to glorify Srila Prabhupada. So for Maharaj, it's like a progression. Yes, he learned many things from many different teachers, but the highest truth he got from Srila Prabhupada. So this is an inclusive way of glorifying. And we see that there are, I met in America and I met in India, thousands of people who would never pick up a didactic book to read. A didactic book means a book that is directly teaching philosophy or a book that is, say, directly glorifying Srila Prabhupada. Because they will see this is just the one particular organization's mouthpiece. So, but they have taken the book and they have read it and they have developed appreciation for Srila Prabhupada. So this was his way of inclusively glorifying Srila Prabhupada. And when I was introduced to Srila Prabhupada's teachings, I often came across how Prabhupada was strong and cutting. He used to condemn illusion. And in fact, I was trained in such a way, one of my services in the early times was, I used to give a series of talk called Smashing Misconceptions. So I thought I was following Srila Prabhupada very faithfully by that. And yes, Prabhupada did that also. So whenever I would hear Maharaj's classes, at that time I would feel that Maharaj's mood seems to be so different from Srila Prabhupada's mood. So what was it about Srila Prabhupada that inspired Maharaj? So of course, both of them are completely devoted to glorifying Krishna. But still, what was the mood seemed to be so different? And then when I think reread the journey home for maybe 10th or 12th time, at that time, it struck me that, so Maharaj has devoted almost an entire chapter in the journey home for Prabhupada's song, the Markine Bhagavad Dharma. If you read the whole book, every single chapter is action filled over there. But this chapter on the Markine Bhagavad Dharma, it is, you could say, it dramatically low in drama. There is very little action in that chapter. Now, as an author, when I structure books, you know, it is important that every chapter conveys something significant so that the reader wants to read something further. So the fact that a significant portion of a chapter, Maharaj has devoted just to this song. Maharaj writes how he got this song and he took it with him and he lay on the banks of the Jamuna, reading this song and pondering its import. So in one particular Vyas Puja talk, Maharaj says, you know, this is the Prabhupada. This, the Prabhupada in the Markine Bhagavad Dharma, that is the Prabhupada that conquered my heart. This is the, if you see the mood of Srila Prabhupada, now, Prabhupada is humble, he's prayerful, he's surrendered. No, this is often the Prabhupada that we in the movement have forgotten, we have overlooked. I wouldn't say we have forgotten entirely. We do sing the Markine Bhagavad Dharma periodically, maybe on Prabhupada appearance day, Prabhupada disappearance day. But the mood of Prabhupada, this is when he is in his communion with Krishna. Simply praying to Krishna, make me an instrument in your hands. Make my words understandable to them. Make me dance, O Lord. So this, I have read what Maharaj writes about this particular song several times. And so this is often the mood of Srila Prabhupada, which we don't talk about. So now within Srila Prabhupada's movement, there are many different spiritual masters. And they all have their different moods. So once I asked, so there are some of the spiritual masters who are very cutting. And they say, so you speak boldly in Prabhupada's service. So then I was working with one such spiritual master as an editor, one such sannyasi guru as an editor for their books. And then I asked Maharaj about the difference in, say, his mood and that spiritual master's mood. And Maharaj said that Prabhupada has preached the way that particular leader is preaching, and Prabhupada has preached the way I am preaching. Prabhupada used different approaches at different times. The important thing is which approach is effective, which approach is actually attracting people to Krishna, and which approach is alienating people from Krishna. So now, if we read the Lilamrut carefully, we'll see there are so many occasions when Prabhupada is not confrontational at all. For example, when Prabhupada is staying at the house of Sally Agarwal and Gopal Agarwal in Butler, Pennsylvania, what happens over there? You know, they have meat in the same fridge where Prabhupada is cooking his bhoga. Now, they have not accepted Prabhupada as their teacher. They do not consider Prabhupada as authority. They consider him as a guest, an elderly guest, due to some respect. And what does Prabhupada do over there? The Prabhupada conducts himself in such a way that at the end of it, what does Sally Agarwal say in her memories of Prabhupada? She said, I have never had any guest in my life who was as easy to host as Swamiji. She said, I didn't have to do anything to entertain Swamiji. If I was busy, he would just chant and keep himself busy. Like, even as devotees, if we consider, if we go to some relative's house, some friend's house, how many of the people who host us will say that this devotee was the easiest guest I have ever had in my life? So what is Srila Prabhupada doing over here? Now, those who are not ready for bhakti, he's at least creating some favorable impressions within their heart. Yes, this is a wonderful person. So Prabhupada was not always confrontational. Prabhupada was in many ways pragmatic. Whatever was required to elevate people's consciousness, he did that. So as I said, I'll be so to illustrate this point of exclusive and inclusive glorification of Srila Prabhupada, which will actually be the theme which will go throughout this presentation, I will introduce one concept. As I said, for me, the way to the heart is through the head. So we can talk about two ideas. There is expansion of consciousness. So at the bottom right, here there is our consciousness, which is a small circle. And we can have expansion of consciousness that's in the horizontal direction. And then there is elevation of consciousness. So what do these two things mean? So if you say expansion of consciousness, what it means is that I start thinking about people other than myself. So I may start thinking about my family, my community, my country, my race, my ethnicity. I start thinking of something bigger than me. Now, I may be thinking of them at a material level. I may be thinking about protecting their bodies, providing for their material welfare. But at least I'm thinking of something bigger than myself. And then there is elevation of consciousness, where we start thinking about spiritual reality. We start thinking about not just matter, but we start thinking about spirit. We start thinking not just about ourselves, we start thinking about God. So there is expansion and there is elevation of consciousness. Now Krishna talks about this. I won't go into technical details of that, but Krishna talks about elevation of consciousness in 12, 8, 9 and 10. And then in 12, 11 in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, for those who can't elevate their consciousness, let them expand their consciousness. If they can't offer, they can't connect with me, Krishna says, let them at least develop some level of selflessness. Let them sacrifice their work for some good cause. So both of them together, I'll come back to this slide again, but both of them, and there is together, there is expansion and there is elevation. Then there is evolution of consciousness. So ultimately, we don't just want elevation, we want evolution. Evolution means the consciousness has to expand in both directions. We are not only concerned for our own spirituality, we are not just concerned for other spirituality, we are concerned for the entire person. When we care for someone, we can't tell them, I care for your soul, I don't care for your body at all. Compassion has to be holistic. Now, going back to this previous story. Now, what happens is, if there is only elevation of consciousness without expansion of consciousness. Now, we think we have become spiritual, but what happens is, we sometimes still say sectarian. We still say narrow-minded. Because what happens? We think, yeah, my consciousness is elevated. And what about others? They are all mundane consciousness. And we stay very narrow-minded. We often become judgmental. And we don't really see how God is acting in different ways in different people's lives. Now, this is the way. And if you're not following this way, you are not only not spiritual, but we may even say that you're demoniac. So quite often when there is elevation of consciousness without expansion, although the person might become spiritually elevated, but they might also become narrow-minded. And in some ways, this is what has happened for many, many of us in our movement. And Maharaj's presentation of bhakti ensures that, you know, there is evolution of consciousness, not just expansion. There is evolution of consciousness, not just elevation. Let me explain what I mean by this, and then we'll move forward. That basically, yes, Krishna has acted in our lives through our spiritual teachers, through our spiritual traditions, but Krishna is not, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that God is not the monopoly of any religion. Now, God is acting in many different ways in different people's lives. So we expand our consciousness, we elevate our consciousness. And that will bring me to the next theme. But the point when I read this journey home is that for those people who are not ready to devote themselves to Krishna right now, for them also, that book provides many ways in which they can appreciate bhakti, they can appreciate Krishna, they can appreciate Srila Prabhupada. So their consciousness can expand. So for somebody who is not ready to commit themselves to Krishna, they may not necessarily see Krishna as their way for spirituality. But they start understanding, oh, this is also, there are very deeply spiritual people over here. So we can take the glories of Srila Prabhupada far beyond the institutional boundaries of the institution that he started. And that is, I would say, one of the singular greatest contributions of Maharaj. There's hardly, and now this is, again, we don't want to compare and minimize, but if I read a book as an author, there are very few other books which have been published in our movement about Srila Prabhupada, which can be appreciated by people who are not yet committed to the movement. Yes, there are some, no doubt. Lilamrut is there. But even Lilamrut Stone is, now if you read from today's perspective, it is quite insider. Now, of course, the movie has come on Srila Prabhupada's life. That is a magnificent contribution. But in terms of literature, yes, there are a few other books written. Miracle on the Second Avenue is there. And there are a few other, Sadhu in a Strange Land. There are books like that, which are written for outside audiences. But in terms of the quality of the experiences, the depth of the spirituality. Hare Krishna? Sorry? Yeah? Sorry, Prabhu. What? Any problem?
Just the voice is.
Oh, is it?
Me or it's happening? I'm not sure.
Oh, okay.
Network issues.
Sorry, so it's interrupting a lot, is it? Let me change my network and see. Okay. Is it better now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So, not clear for you. Okay. Thank you. So, basically, this is a book by which, you know, there is opportunities for those who want to elevate their consciousness. Wonderful. Those who don't want to elevate their consciousness, provide them a facility for expanding their consciousness. So, of course, The Journey Home is just a beautifully written book. In terms of literary value, it is great. But in terms of spiritual value, it is extraordinary. So, when Maharaj followed that up with Journey Home, with Journey Within, so he basically, what he did, when I asked Maharaj about this, this is like, what is your vision? So, he says, those who are attracted by The Journey Home, now, yes, if they have some curiosity for spiritual bhakti, then help them to grow further in their spiritual journey. And so at that time, when The Journey Within was, Maharaj has been writing that book for many years, although it was published a few years ago. So at that time, I also had a little narrow view of spirituality. I had the idea that elevation of consciousness without much expansion. So when Maharaj is writing about understanding who is a spiritual teacher, and so I said, Maharaj had asked me to, after I read the book, to edit some of the sections. And so then I suggested to Maharaj some things. You know, Maharaj, you can talk about how we should be spiritual seekers, not spiritual shoppers. But how we need to commit ourselves if we want to grow spiritually. And then Maharaj looked at me very intently and he said that the only reason people are going to read my book is because they are spiritual shoppers. If they were spiritual seeker, they would either be in our path or they would be in some other path. So he said, you cannot demand commitment from people. You cannot instruct people to become committed. You have to inspire people. And that will happen through personal association. So that was for me a very important lesson, that we cannot demand commitment. We cannot instruct people, you have to become committed. Rather, by our example, by our association, by our conduct, we need to inspire people to become committed. So this is, again, Maharaj is opening the doors for those who are not ready to commit. Just welcome them and keep the door open for them. As many steps as they want to take, we provide them facility for coming that much toward Krishna. So it's not like a 1-0 spirituality. Either you are in, you are out. No, if you can't be one, you can be 0.3, 0.5, 0.7. It's analog spirituality. Even if you take one step toward Krishna, then it is a significant step forward for that soul. So Maharaj told me at that time that, you know, for people who are sometimes so far away from Krishna, if they just appreciate a devotee of Krishna, that not just appreciate in a heartfelt way, oh, I met a nice person, this is such a thoughtful person, such a pleasant person. He says that can be a quantum leap in their spiritual life. And he showed me a quote of Prabhupada. He said that if somebody even appreciates Prabhupada, Krishna once, Krishna will ensure that they will become devoted to him in due course. So this was the first point about how Maharaj is providing multiple facilities for people to both elevate their consciousness if they want to become committed, to expand their consciousness and appreciate Krishna at whatever level they are at. So any reflections on this?
Mentioned about how Maharaj has glorified Prabhupada in a very, very inclusive way. I never thought in this. I read many times Journey Home, but the way you brought it out was really wonderful, how the glorification of Srila Prabhupada, how Maharaj actually, he never demeaned anyone whom he met, but he does mention in the Journey Home that all the teachings which I found, which I learned, is all there in what Srila Prabhupada, and in a way, and his compassion. That's what attracted Maharaj. Very beautifully you brought it out. Thank you, Prabhu.
Yes, thank you, Rachendra. Yes, Vilas Manjari Mataji.
Yeah, thank you so much, Prabhu, for sharing all the points about Guru Maharaj. I just want to quickly say that thank you for telling that we have to appreciate and respect whatever level other person is, and take it from there. Because I, in my experience, while sharing with some non-devotees who are not into KC, I would feel resentment, especially when they showed no interest in Krishna, especially like... whenever I would talk about them, their feelings, they would prolong the conversation. But the moment I used to speak about Krishna, they would show disinterest or make reasons to, you know, change the topic. Or I mean, in the sense, like, they would hear to some extent about Krishna. But when I went into too much speaking about Krishna, they would show disinterest. So that kind of made me angry on them, like, you know, how much they're in sense confusion like that. So I kind of felt like giving up association or minimizing also, but this point really helped me, what you shared about Guru Devas. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, of course, if somebody is not interested in Krishna, we don't have to spend lots of time with them, but we don't have to dismiss them either. You know, we can be shrewd about how much time we spend, but in that time, let that interaction not be unpleasant. Even if you spend a brief time with them, let it be a pleasant interaction. As you said, you know, if you talk with them, just inquire about them, how they are doing in a genuine way. That's enough. People, not everybody wants to have hours of conversation, but the conversation that we do have with them, how we can keep it warm. So if they can't appreciate Krishna, let them appreciate at least a devotee of Krishna. Thank you. So Krishna Chaitanand Prabhu's said that, you know, this point of expansion and elevation, yes, that's a very important point. Okay, can we keep have questions a little bit later? Right now, let's keep reflections. about this point of, but if some devotees don't appreciate other religions, well, what can you do? Everybody has their mood. Once Maharaj was in Kumbh Mela, and there was some like a Hindu nationalist kind of leader who said, "So Swamiji, which religion were you born in?" He said, "Jewish religion." And then I was born in Jewish religion. He says, "Then why did you embrace Hinduism? Why did you start worshipping Krishna?" So Maharaj said that, doesn't this mean that our Hindu religion is superior to a Jewish religion? So Maharaj said, all religions are paths to God, and we can all move toward God through various authentic religions. Then why did you choose Hindu? Doesn't that mean Hinduism is superior? So he kept hammering that point. And finally, Maharaj just looked straight at him and Maharaj said, "You know, I chose the path of bhakti because Krishna attracted my heart like no one else." So here, he's not claiming, like at a philosophical level. I was talking to Shyamanandaru recently, and Shyamanandaru told me that Maharaj told him once, he says, "Never once in my life have I ever said that Krishna consciousness is the supreme religion." He said, "This is a matter of the heart. Of course, we can argue at the level of the philosophy. If there are particular misconceptions to be addressed." But he said that the important thing is our heart has to be attracted toward Krishna. So if our heart is attracted to Krishna, then that is the best path for us. We don't have to try to go about trying to parade the superiority of our path to others. So, yes, but some devotees may have the idea that some religions are of a particular kind. And that's a whole different subject. But yes, there are, of course, extremist elements in every religion. In some religions, they may be more than less. More, in some religions, they might be less. But it's a problem everywhere. And either we can look at the extremist elements and say that it's bad. We can look at the spiritual elements within them and appreciate that. So important thing is we become attracted towards the Lord and grow spiritually. Not just that we say that my path is the greatest. So thank you. We'll move on. Now, as I said, the second point I was going to talk about, the Bhaktivedanta Hospital. So now, the Bhaktivedanta Hospital is sometimes being criticized because Prabhupada said that, you know, there are Advaitic missions who open hospitals, and why should we, you know, they equate the body with the soul and they have no proper understanding. So Prabhupada has criticized spiritual teachers getting into humanitarian compassion, and now why would Maharaj open a hospital and Prabhupada has criticized that? So the first point to understand is that what was Prabhupada criticizing? And humanitarian compassion is a worthy, a noble feature of human life. Now we see, is there when in the Bhagavatam, when Maharaj Shibi or Maharaj Rantidev, you know, there Maharaj Rantidev offers his own food after fasting for a long time to humans, to at that time considered low caste humans, and even to animals. And Maharaj Shibi, what to speak of offering his own food, is offering his own flesh. So they are not differentiating, oh, this is mundane and this is spiritual. They are just being compassionate. So compassion is an integral part of our tradition. So why should we, if compassion is a part of the broad Vedic tradition, so should we let Advaitic missions have a monopoly on humanitarian compassion for all of the future? You know, hospitals are places where people come in need. And if at that time they are treated physically and they are offered some spiritual help, they take it up very, very, very gratefully, very receptively. So there are other organizations, there are Christians who have missionary hospitals, and people go there and they get at least impressed by Christianity, even if they don't get converted. So there are others who are using hospitals to share or to spread their own influence. So, and we don't want to characterize them as they're only driven by agenda of conversion. They may have a motive of service also, but do we want to let them have a monopoly on humanitarian compassion? And because Prabhupada has criticized humanitarian compassion, does that mean it has become untouchable for all of us, for all ISKCON devotees, for all generations to come? What Prabhupada criticized was something very specific and careful. At that time, when both Prabhupada was there and before Bhaktivinoda Thakur was there, so the Advaitic missions which were existing, they criticized bhakti. So you spend so much money on deity worship and you don't actually care for the poor people who are starving outside the temples. And they said, don't see God in the deity, see God in the heart of the poor person. So manav seva hi madhav seva hai. And with that attitude, what they said, they opened hospitals. And they said, God, basically, it was with the Advaitic conception that everyone is Brahman, everyone is God. So, but that is not the only motive with which humanitarian compassion can be done. We can have humanitarian compassion in another entirely different framework. And that is where we see everyone as a precious part of God, a beloved child of God. And Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur himself had a whole residential place for lepers. In those times, leprosy was considered not just a physical disease, it was considered to be a spiritual malaise. And people with leprosy were treated like untouchables. So Bhaktivinoda Swami Thakur had a whole place open for them where they were cared for and they all became devoted. So even in our tradition, caring for sick in a holistic, for sick people in a holistic way is there. So now, if you see what has happened, what has been done through Bhaktivinoda Hospital, not only is when compassion and devotion are combined together, the number of people who can be reached are far, far more than what anyone else would be, than what would be normally reached. But the people who would never come to a temple, they come to a hospital and they have the darshan of Srila Prabhupada as soon as they enter the hospital. Anywhere they are in the hospital, they hear Prabhupada's Hare Krishna Dhun. They get the darshan of Jagannath. So there is nothing Advaitic about anything in the hospital. It's completely permeated with devotion. And many, many Srila Prabhupada disciples also, who were initially apprehensive about the idea of the hospital, have then become very, very appreciative about it. So the idea is, just criticize it. Prabhupada said, don't build hospitals. Okay, what was the point of Prabhupada saying that? If you don't consider that, then what are we doing? We are doing Niyamagraha. Niyamagraha is, one meaning is, to insist on the letter of the law without understanding its spirit. So the letter of the law is, okay, Prabhupada said, why should spiritual people have hospitals? But what was the context? What was the intent? What was the import? He said that those who are at a spiritual level, why are they coming down to the mundane level? Well, if you see in the Bhaktivinoda Hospital, nobody who is spiritual is coming down at the mundane level. It is not that, say, if we want to talk about, it's not that, say, brahmacharis and sannyasis are managing the hospitals. It is, brahmacharis and sannyasis are going there, they may go there for their own treatment, or they may go there to give classes to elevate people's consciousness to the spiritual level. So see what is happening. You can't just take a letter and just take one particular statement and make it like a blanket ban on hospitals for all time to come. And this is for the people who come, doors are being opened for them. Along with that, for the people who are working there. When His Holiness Devamrat Maharaj came to the Bhaktivinoda Hospital, I think second or third time, he said that this is practically the only working model of Varanashram, is among the few working models of Varanashram that we have in the world today. Now, what do we mean by working model of Varanashram? Varanashram, the essence is not simply dividing people into classes or castes or groups. The essence of Varanashram is to engage people according to their natures so that their material professions can harmonize with their spiritual aspirations. So there was a significant pool of devotees of doctors who had become devotees. Now, what are they to do if they have to work together? If they have to work, either they can go and work in commercial hospitals where there are unethical practices, where there is exploitative mentality, and there is no devotional atmosphere, or they come together and they make a hospital where they, their own material professional needs are taken care of, but in a way that is conducive for their spiritual growth. So the essence of Varnashram is to harmonize one's material and spiritual life. And that is what is being done over here. So there were many devotees who initially, many of these devotee doctors, they had such a missionary spirit. They just wanted to join the temple and be brahmacharis. But then after some time, they realized that they realized, and their spiritual guides also felt that they could do much more service as doctors to people. Then they started having a traveling medical van where they're going and reaching out to people. But then they felt that we can actually reach out to people much more if we have one solid place where people can visit. You know, as a medical van, they will just go and we can do some influence. The influence will be much more. So the Bhaktivedanta Hospital, far from being anything like spiritual coming down to the material level, it is actually providing many, many people the way to rise from material consciousness to spiritual consciousness. And in that sense, it's serving both purposes, integrating compassion with devotion for those who are, we could say, outsiders. And it is providing a Varnashram-like setting for those who are insiders over there. So, and if you look at the sheer number of, now I have spent some time at the hospital, and many others, some of you others may have, the sheer number of people, number of programs that happen, number of people who become devotees. There is no criticism. There is a temple nearby, a very beautiful temple has come up nearby, the Mira Road Temple. But before that temple came up, the number of people who were inspired to a devotion by the hospital was comparable to, if not more than, the number of people who are inspired to a devotion by the temple. Now, of course, temple attracts a particular kind of people, but people who would not go to the temple, they would come to the hospital, they would go inspired by that, then they would go to the temple. So this is simply expanding the reach. And so Maharaj, now generally we think of Maharaj as very gentle and very cooperative and very considerate, very respectful to his god brothers. Yes, he's that. Definitely he is. But he's also determined. If he's inspired from within his heart by Srila Prabhupada, by Krishna, that a particular way is there to serve Krishna, to serve Srila Prabhupada, then even if there are others who may not agree, Maharaj will persist in that. And of course, he has demonstrated the truth of what he is, of his vision has manifested in a way that has few parallels on the planet today. So that is the second point about the Bhaktivedanta Hospital, the improvised Varanashram, and the integrating compassion with devotion. So any quick reflections on this? Yes, Revati Pati Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Very glad to hear from you after a long time. And the point which you told about the Bhaktivedanta Hospital is so very wonderful, actually, because oftentimes even as devotees, we wonder, you know, because Prabhupada has been writing and being vocal about it quite often. But the perspective you provided, you know, that it is not a replacement for the devotion, or it's not a replacement of pure devotion service, but it is actually can bring people closer to that. And we can say that Falina Parichayat is that actually Bhaktivedanta Hospital has been so successful in doing that. And also, you know, as devotees being a part of the material world, we also need medical care. And I mean, I have been taking my parent to some hospitals. It's so difficult to find out who is the right person and how they will treat and what money they will charge, because, you know, you can't do without trust, and keeping trust is so difficult. So Bhaktivedanta Hospital has done something very amazing, actually. And also one more factor I would like to reflect and add, which might make some sense. Prabhupada times, the whole community lived in temples. So anything done by a devotee, it was considered like a temple initiative or like, you know, full-time devotee kind of doing it. And the devotees living outside the temple and contributing in these ways, connecting to the society in this way to make devotees in long term, was not a very common practice. But these days, if you see that, you know, most of the ISKCON devotees are outside the temple. And this presents a very perfect model, actually, to how to actually, as you rightly said, that combine our devotional and occupational duties so well together. So very thankful for giving this insight. It's a very, very brilliant presentation. Clarified so many kind of misconceptions and doubt about this Advaitic conception of, you know, taking care of the human being and why Prabhupada was criticized so heavily and how this can be accommodated within property. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you, Venkat Bhatt Prabhu. I can read out your comment, or would you like to read it out? I'm happy either way. Okay, so Venkat Bhatt Prabhu is saying that the critique of mundane welfare work that Srila Prabhupada and others make is a criticism of those who bring spiritual consciousness down to the material level. Yes, Maharaj is showing how material, seemingly material activities can elevate consciousness to the spiritual level. Yes. So it's a beautiful point that is provided that actually Maharaj is providing a positive alternative to what Prabhupada is criticizing. He's not doing what Prabhupada is criticizing, but he's actually providing a positive alternative, a different way of doing that thing. So yeah, that's very well articulated. Thank you. So I'll move on to thank you. Thank you, Venkat Bhatt Prabhu. So let's move on to the third point now. So now Western outreach is a big point in itself. And I'll just mention a few things about it. Now what Revati Pati Prabhu mentioned about the temple, most people not living in the temple. Now that is something very relevant over here for us. Now, some of you might be in the West, and our movement is in some ways flourishing in the West, but it is flourishing with Indian devotees, and that's wonderful. But Prabhupada, wherever he went, he wanted the local people also to practice bhakti, and that is not happening. So when I met Maharaj in Chicago, and I asked him for some guidelines about, you know, what all do we need to do for reaching out to Western people. So Maharaj told several things to me. The first thing he told me is that Western people are fed up with sectarianism. If anything seems sectarian, forget it. I want nothing to do with it. If they feel that religion has caused enough divisions, enough conflicts in this world, and I don't want to be a part of something that is going to create further conflicts. And unfortunately, we can come off as very sectarian, either by the way we might dismiss other spiritual paths and other spiritual teachers, or simply by the way we dress and we conduct ourselves. So another way people think of something as sectarian is if it is associated with a particular institution, and okay, this is a particular group, and that is what this group is doing. So in some way, so when I read the Journey Home book, what happens is, in today's world, people are very interested in spirituality. In fact, Maharaj told me that he feels that even the Western world today is riper for Krishna Bhakti than what it was at the time of 1960s when Srila Prabhupada came. However, we are not able to reach those people. And several of the reasons, as I said, we come off as sectarian quite a bit. So people are interested today, those who are seekers, they are interested in spiritual individuals. They are not interested in religious institutions. It's two different things. They're not interested in religious institutions. They're interested in spiritual teachers or spiritual individuals. So what happens because of, what is the difference? Now, if somebody presents themselves as an institutional leader, then immediately there is skepticism. You belong to an institution, you are going to toe the party line. And you are just a mouthpiece. You are like a advertising agent for a particular company. You are always going to say your product is very good. What else are you going to say for that? So there is skepticism if somebody is seen as a teacher or a head of a religious institution. But if somebody is a spiritual individual, then there is interest. Now, how would they define somebody as a spiritual individual? No, by the kind of experiences they have had, by the kind of behavior they exhibit, by the kind of virtues they manifest. So one of the common sayings in this group of people, spiritual but not religious, is that don't tell me what you believe, show me how you behave. Don't tell me what you believe, show me how you behave. Unfortunately, we spend a lot of time telling people what they should believe and what they should not believe. And that just doesn't work. So if you see the whole Journey Home stone, it is not telling people what to believe. It is Maharaj telling how he arrived at particular understandings. Okay. He doesn't compromise anything. He brings in the four regulative principles in the Journey Home itself, what to speak of the journey within. But he doesn't bring it as these are to be followed, otherwise you're sinful. He brings it through his own story. He saw a cow and he saw, this is such a loving, living being. How can anyone eat that? So tell your experiences, and that brings a huge amount of authenticity. Rather than this is the truth, how I arrived at this truth, how I realized that this is true. We show that the reach from that is enormous. And that is what the Journey Home is doing. Now, when I read the Journey Home, now I searched, how often does Maharaj talk about ISKCON? And in the entire Journey Home, you can check that if you have an ebook. In the entire Journey Home, the name ISKCON comes only once. And when is that? That is when Maharaj is introducing Prabhupada. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, he founded the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. And there he mentions ISKCON in bracket. So Maharaj never says that I joined ISKCON. He says that after he met Srila Prabhupada, he was inspired by Srila Prabhupada. He came to New Vrindavan and he lived in a community, lived in a setting similar to how Ghanshyam Baba was living, taking care of cows, worshipping the deities. So people are not interested in religious institutions, but they're interested in spiritual individuals. So again, the same point, reaching out to people beyond the boundaries of the institution. So Journey Home and Journey Within have done that in a way that has actually not been done much in our movement. So there is no sectarianism within the movement. And what people want to see is, okay, what is the transformation that has happened in you? What is the authentic transformation? And then, okay, whatever you believe, that's okay. I don't care what you believe, but how does it add value to my life? How can it help me to become a better person? Not add value in terms of I want to have my prayers fulfilled, I want money, but how can it help me to become a better person? How can it help me to become, say, more forgiving, more tolerant? How can I find more meaning in my life? How can I become more equipoised in facing life? So after I read Journey, now I also had the service of editing Journey Within. And of course, Mara said that so many people actually edited Journey Within for him. But one thing that struck me when I read Journey Within, I was not able to articulate, that this book is different from the other books on philosophy that I have read. And then it struck me that Journey Within is actually not presenting philosophy, it is presenting wisdom. Now, what is the difference between philosophy and wisdom? It's a subtle but very significant difference. And that brings me to the first point over there. We need to meet people where they are, not where we are. So one example I'll give you of differentiating between philosophy and wisdom. See, if I say that, I'm going to give a class on karma and destiny and reincarnation. That is philosophy. Some people might be interested in it. many might not be okay. Maybe karma exists, maybe it doesn't. Reincarnation, I don't bother about it. And destiny, it doesn't matter. It may or may not interest people. But I can take the same, I can speak the essentially the same theme. But if I present it as, how can we find meaning in suffering? Finding meaning in suffering. Now this people see as wisdom. Oh, this is something which I want to learn. So philosophy is sometimes seen as otherworldly. But wisdom is seen something as, it might have some otherworldly elements to it. But it is something which is going to help me here and now. It is going to reach me where I am. And this is actually Maharaj's expertise in presenting. This is done in the journey home, that he's presented philosophy, but the focus is not on presenting philosophy, it's presenting wisdom that can help people where they are at. There is that beautiful story of Dorothy which comes in the book. It's actually helping her in her need. He's sharing wisdom over there. And if you see, even when Maharaj narrates, say, Chaitanya Charita, Chaitanya Leela or Krishna Leela, they are very sublime pastimes, and he narrates them in such a captivating way. However, after all of these, whenever he narrates the pastimes, he gives some wisdom. And the wisdom is what? He focuses on the values that we can add in our life. The values we can learn. Service attitude, humility, sacrifice, selflessness, kindness towards others, compassion. So these are values we can add in our life. So that is what Maharaj has always been doing, in one sense, even when he has been presenting direct devotional content to devotees. So Maharaj doesn't get too much into philosophical technicalities. When he's asked questions, he can very systematically say refute Advaitic misconceptions or other kinds of misconceptions. But that is never his thrust. So once there are some controversial issues. So I had made some statements, and those controversial issues became, there are many issues which can be controversial in our philosophy. So when that had happened, I asked Maharaj, how do we deal with controversial issues? So Maharaj told me that, what is your purpose? So whether it is the moon issue or evolution issue or whatever issue it might be, what is our purpose? Our purpose is to get people closer to Krishna. So these issues are not important. We have limited time with them, with people, and we need to focus on the issues that matter. So we don't have to get into controversy. Of course, if there are controversies that need to be addressed, we can address them. But we don't have to go out of the way to create controversies. We don't have to focus on them. We focus on the values that are central for us. Imagine if we had just 5 minutes with somebody, and that's the only time we're going to meet them. Now, why should we want to talk about the intelligence level of a particular gender or a particular political leader's views or a particular or anything else, or the moon mission? Now, whether we went to the moon or not, now that is not going to determine whether we will go back to Godhead or not. You know, what will determine is how much are we Krishna conscious. So Maharaj has always focused on this value addition, and that's what he has specially done in Western outreach. Now, there's one more important point, and this is, I'll come to Western outreach, but this is something which is critical. So when I was, I met Maharaj in Chicago, he told me that when we talk about outreach, he says there are two different things. There is people for whom we open the doors to Krishna. That means those people are already interested in Krishna, and we open the door so that they can come to Krishna. This can be literally, it can be, we open the temple doors. It can also be, we connect them with Krishna through whatever other way it is. But there is an entire other group of people who open the doors for us to take Krishna to others. They open the doors, so they may themselves never come to Krishna, but they can open the doors for us to take Krishna to others. And the way we deal with these two people is very different. The people who, so the topic here was, I talked about service, Maharaj's expertise in sharing devotional service, and talked about when to share devotion and when to share service. So this is related with these two categories. If I go to the next slide, I'll come back here. So devotion means we elevate people's desires. You know, we bring them closer to Krishna. Going back to earlier point of elevating people's consciousness. But service means, okay, this is where you are. We engage people's present desires in some way in getting them to do some service to Krishna. So I'll give some examples of this category. So sometimes if somebody is not, we open the door to Krishna for someone, and if they don't come in, we sometimes get so angry that we just bang the door in their face. And so we sometimes talk about this verse. You know, Prabhupada would quote that it is Ekaschandrastamohanti Ritstara Sahasrashaha, that one moon is better than 1,000 stars. And Prabhupada's implication was that one committed devotee is better than many 1,000 lukewarm people, which is true. But unfortunately, in the name of finding that one moon, it's one thing to choose the one moon and to overlook the 1,000 stars. But for many of us, what happens is we focus on extinguishing the 1,000 stars instead of finding the one moon. And so many people get alienated because of what they perceive as the disrespectful attitude of devotees. When I travel across the world, somehow, I don't know why, I attract many of the people who have been wounded by our own outreach. And then we have to try to recover the wounds. So we are meant to extinguish the forest fires of material existence. But sometimes it is our own insensitive preaching that sets up forest fires. And then we have to spend time extinguishing those. So again, let me elaborate these two categories. So people for whom we open the doors to Krishna, and people who open the doors to Krishna for us. So that we can take Krishna to other people. Now, what does the second category mean? If we consider, so Maharaj gave me this example of Allen Ginsberg. Let me see if I can quickly. This today morning has given another class. Yeah. So when Prabhupada met Allen Ginsberg, now we have all heard about him, but Maharaj told me that Allen Ginsberg was actually, he used to take drugs, and he was a campaigner for taking drugs for spiritual growth. He, along with Timothy Leary, were the prominent people who propagated that idea that you should take drugs for growing, for spiritual growth. And so he was, we could say in one sense, he was not only breaking the regulative principle, he was actually actively campaigning for the breaking of the regulative principle, and that too as a means to spiritual growth. So we cannot think of somebody who was so, we could say, so directly contradictory to what Prabhupada stood for and what Prabhupada taught. On top of that, Allen Ginsberg was an active gay, and whenever he would come to meet Prabhupada, he would come with his male partner. And how did Prabhupada deal with him? In one of the most prominent youth programs, there was in Ohio State University, there are several thousand students over there. And Allen Ginsberg was there, and Prabhupada told him, you lead the kirtan. In fact, Prabhupada told him, you give the class, you give the talk also, and I will add a few words afterward. And Allen Ginsberg said, no, Swami, this is your tradition, you should give the talk. Prabhupada said, you sing the kirtan, you lead the kirtan. And Prabhupada said that you have been blessed, especially by Krishna. So what did Prabhupada see over there? Prabhupada, he had many, many faults. So, you know, if you wanted to count the faults, you could count many, many faults. But Prabhupada saw one good thing in him. What was that? He had the desire to sing Krishna's names. And Prabhupada fanned that. So the idea is, Allen Ginsberg never came to Krishna. He never became a committed disciple of Srila Prabhupada. But before Prabhupada met George Harrison, he was the most prominent celebrity who was connected with Prabhupada. And many, many people came to Krishna because they heard Allen Ginsberg singing about the Hare Krishna mantra, And he would say, you know, if you want to know more about this, you can learn from Bhaktivedanta Swami. So he was in that category of people who opened the door to Krishna for us. So, you know, these people need to be dealt with in a special way. What is that way? That is, we can't push them too much. You have to come to Krishna, otherwise you are demoniac. No, they may not come to Krishna, but they can open the doors to Krishna for us to take Krishna to others. And what was earlier mentioned about, during Prabhupada's time, everybody lived in the temple. That is true in America. In India, most of the people who joined Srila Prabhupada or most of the people who connected with Srila Prabhupada connected at the capacity of life members. And they were people who actually never became, very few of his followers became committed, very few of those life members became his disciples. But they helped Prabhupada in very big ways. And how was that? They helped Prabhupada build the magnificent temples that we have. So now most of those people, life members who were there, they were already connected with some spiritual teacher, some spiritual tradition. And Giriraj Maharaj has written recently a book about the Juhu temple. And I had the opportunity to offer some editorial contribution in that book. So I asked Maharaj that, and I asked this to Giriraj Maharaj, and I asked this to Radhanath Maharaj also. So he said, when Prabhupada met these life members, and you know, they would often have their own altars, and altars they would have the picture of the spiritual teachers. So how did Prabhupada deal with them? Both Maharaj told me that was never an issue, he says. But Prabhupada didn't talk about them at all. So Prabhupada didn't criticize, oh, you're worshipping this teacher and that teacher. No, they had not accepted Prabhupada as their guru. So Prabhupada saw they were already very committed to that particular spiritual path. So they were not ready to be elevated in the devotional way. So Prabhupada engaged them. They had a pious desire to build temples for Krishna, and Prabhupada engaged them. So they never came to Krishna, but they opened the doors for him so that temples could be built and he could take Krishna to many, many people. So this is what Maharaj is doing through primarily in his Western outreach. See, in the West, you know, in the last 20, 30 years, things have changed so much that, you know, for people to come to the level of becoming initiated devotees, where they follow the four regs and chant 16 rounds, it's extremely difficult. But many people become favorable and then they rise gradually. So the kind of people which through Maharaj Western outreach he has reached, it is after Srila Prabhupada, very few other spiritual leaders have been able to reach people at that level. Bhaktivedanta Maharaj did that to some extent in Africa as well as in America. And it was Bhaktivedanta Maharaj who inspired Maharaj also to do this same thing. So the point is that there are people who need to be engaged where they are at. And when they engage, they will grow at their pace. So the idea is we don't force spirituality on them. We don't force them to become spiritual. We provide them an experience of spirituality at whatever level they are ready. And then they rise up from there. So I'll just, in this theme, I'll talk about the Govardhan Eco Village and then we can have some reflections or questions. So then when I was once here in Govardhan Eco Village, I asked Maharaj, Maharaj, what was your vision in starting the Govardhan Eco Village? So first Maharaj said that, you know, I'm not a very strategic thinker. He says, you know, however Krishna inspires me, you know, I actually that morning I had given a Bhagavatam class, and so Maharaj had come and attended that class. And actually Maharaj hears the Bhagavatam classes usually in the Radha Govinda temple, but in his room. But that day he came and attended the Bhagavatam class. He sat down throughout the class. And in that class, I had spoken about instincts and impulses. So I said, impulses are where we do something which is unintelligent. So lust, anger, greed, these are impulses. So they are unintelligent, whereas instincts are like programmed intelligence. So, you know, intelligence that has become internalized within us. So some people have, say, good musical instincts. Some people have good cooking instincts. Some people have good decorational instincts. Some people have good writing instincts. This will work well. So I said the instincts can come from our past karma and they can develop by our training. So Maharaj immediately, you know, he connected with that class, what I had spoken in the morning. I met him in the afternoon. And Maharaj said that, so I am not a very strategic person. He said, I act, and Maharaj just smiled at me, not according to my impulses, but according to my instincts. And then he added, but my instincts have been trained and purified by 40 years of chanting, 10 years of 40, 50 years of chanting, 10 years of doing deity worship, and then 20, 30 years of community building. And then before that, my entire journey home experiences. So he said, with these instincts, so I found that the most important thing that we need in today's world for reaching people is to understand what the current cultural need is, what the current culture is. So he said, Prabhupada tapped into that culture. When he went to the West, at that time, there was the counterculture over there. And the counterculture meant that people were rejecting. The hippies had rejected mainstream society. They had rejected mainstream education, mainstream politics, American mainstream politics, mainstream culture, everything. And then Prabhupada presented things in a very confrontational way. In a sense, it just gelled perfectly. Because what they had rejected already, Prabhupada gave them intellectual foundation, intellectual justification for the rejection. So the two blended very nicely. However, when Prabhupada came back to India, now we do say that when Prabhupada didn't go, Prabhupada was in India preaching, Indians were not interested so much. Now the fact is that when Prabhupada came back to India in 1970s, even then Indians were not interested in committed spiritual life. So after I had this discussion with Maharaj, Maharaj mentioned this point to me, and then I read many of Prabhupada's conversations and lectures in India, and it struck me how this was a common theme. So Indians were fascinated by Prabhupada and the Western disciples with a sense of cultural nationalism. Oh, you know, these foreigners, they ruled us for so long, and now they are adopting our culture. And this Swamiji, he has taught our culture to them. This is glorious. And Prabhupada engaged their feelings of cultural nationalism. There are lectures where Prabhupada says that the Bhagavad Gita is the message from India. But to teach the Bhagavad Gita in India, I have to get people from abroad. This is your message. Learn it. You say, I am one Indian and I have done so much. If you take it up, you can do so much more. So, when people were engaged at the level of cultural nationalism, they didn't become committed devotees, but Prabhupada engaged them. And at that time, there was so much prestige associated with our movement in India. But Prabhupada's disciple told me that he once went to a person who thought he would become a life member. And then he saw on their nameplate, you know, people often write on the nameplate their degrees. So you might write, BA, LLB, this, that. So on his nameplate, he had written ISKCON life member. So it had become such a matter of pride. Oh, this is an organization which has made Western people into devotees. So, and it was specifically cultural nationalism. There have been other spiritual teachers who had gone abroad and they had also had disciples, but their disciples didn't adopt, Indian culture, wearing dhoti, kurta, sari. So it was not that dramatic. So Prabhupada engaged that. Prabhupada channeled that. So he said that whoever has been successful in sharing any message, they have understood the cultural current of the time and they've used it to take people toward Krishna. So he said that in the Western world and in the Westernized world, one of the strongest cultural currents. Now, in the culture, there might be many different currents. And not all of them are favorable to Krishna Bhakti. But he said the cultural current that is very receptive to Krishna Bhakti today is the environmental movement. So the the environmental consciousness is very close to spiritual consciousness. So he says, so if we can show people, so people who are generally concerned about the environment, they're already having some level of expanded consciousness. Otherwise, they, especially in the Western world, there is so much comfort and so much luxury available that people could just spend their lives entirely in just gratification. But if people are concerned about environment, and there are a large number of people, or there are a significant number of people are concerned about it, so they are already having expanded consciousness. So if we can show them how our philosophy, our tradition, our spirituality can make a difference in this planet, then that will have a profound effect on them. And this is what I have also seen. There are many places where devotees are doing Western outreach. And when I was there in America, I went to several of those places. And two of the leaders of that place told me that we had people who were staying with us for a year, 6 months, one, and they were interested. They were okay, serious. But then they went to India, they went to Govardhan Eco Village. And then they experienced the spirituality, or they saw spirituality in action. Not just action in terms of, okay, you chant Hare Krishna and you become purified. But in action in terms of how can you help make the world a better place? How can you help solve the problems of the world as the world perceives it? Now, we may tell people the real problems of the world are birth, old age, disease and death. Now, philosophical people will understand that. But for people who are socially conscious, for them, there are problems of, say, the environmental pollution. There are problems of poverty. There are problems of inequality. There are problems of, say, gender discrimination, racial discrimination. These are real problems for them. And, you know, we redefine problems and offer solutions. That is not going to appeal to them. We have to show them how what they see as problems are solvable by our wisdom. So Govardhan Eco Village provides an opportunity like that. Now, of course, that is not the only thing that Govardhan Eco Village does. The environmental awareness and the sustainable living that is being demonstrated here is extraordinary. I am right now in the Govardhan Eco Village. But apart from that, there are another principle that Maharaj said is that, you know, that we want to, when I asked him about yoga, now, Prabhupada often says yoga is for the body and we should focus on bhakti. So Maharaj told me that actually, now we need to provide people as many ways as possible for associating with devotees and experiencing Krishna. So for us, the sustainability movement, the environmental movement, yes, we are actually demonstrating sustainability, but through that, we are giving people an opportunity to experience Krishna, to experience an association of devotees. Through yoga, it's the same principle. Now, of course, if somebody is going into yoga, they need to teach yoga. But the difference is that there are some people who will be interested in direct philosophy. Yes, I'll come and attend a class. And I want to hear the class and I want to learn. But many people find that as too intrusive, too threatening. You know, that means you are trying to convert me. You are trying to indoctrinate me with your philosophy. I'm not interested in that. So what happens is, through yoga, through environmental movement, what Maharaj earlier did through his cooking classes. So now it is veganism is a very big thing. So through this, what we do is we provide people a non-threatening way to experience, a non-threatening, non-intrusive way to experience Krishna, to be in the association of devotees. So for example, if somebody comes to the Govardhan Eco Village, there's a beautiful temple, but the temple is designed in such a way that even if somebody is not interested in devotion, they can just appreciate the temple as a cultural landmark. We see the Madan Mohan temple, we see the Radhavan Vihari temple. The artistry there is so beautiful. And apart from that, there are so many other things. There are cows, there are animal shelters, there is the replica of Govardhan. There are so many beautiful things that people can experience. And if they do all this experience in the association of devotees, then they're getting a taste of Krishna Bhakti. So for people who are not at all interested in, who are very almost hostile or suspicious about getting converted, now they can get a warm, non-threatening experience of Krishna. In fact, the devotees here in Govardhani College, they told us that, when some people come here, we never tell anyone to chant Hare Krishna. They see us chanting and they may ask and they may start chanting. In fact, if some devotees, some Western people start chanting, Maharaj asks them, who told you to start chanting? He says, no, we just saw everyone doing, we did it. So we don't want to force spirituality on anyone because people are fed up with that. And, there are many ways in which, especially in America, evangelical Christianity is quite aggressive. And somebody trying to thrust their philosophy down others' throats, thrust their religion, thrust their ideology down others' throats, that people have no patience with that. I was in Texas and I saw one car. The car had a sticker on its bumper. And that sticker said, "Oh God, please save me from your preachers. Please save me from your preachers." So the idea is these preachers are so preachy. They are so condescending. They are so holier than thou. I just don't want to have anything to do with them. So people come from that framework. And that's why bhakti has to be presented in a very non-threatening, non-intrusive way to them. And that is what the Govardhan Eco Village is doing. And when I travel across America and I go to yoga studios and I go to other such places, there are so many people who have had some exposure with someone who has been to the Eco Village, who has heard about the Eco Village, who has had good experiences over there. And in that way, the good word is spreading, and people who would never ever consider connecting with ISKCON as an institution are still getting connected with Krishna. And that is, let's say, the expertise of Maharaj. So basically, when people come here, even if they're not interested in devotion, they can do some service. They may want to support some animal shelter. They may want to support some sustainability. They may just buy some eco-friendly products. So give them some way to connect with Krishna and give them some way to take one step forward toward Krishna. And actually, to do all this requires an extraordinary level of compassion as well as commitment. I'll conclude with this point, that it requires extraordinary level of compassion and commitment. When Maharaj is in India, and if he just, any talk that he gives, easily 1,000 people would be there for a talk. If a talk is well organized, several thousands of people would come. When Maharaj gives talks in America, depending on where he's giving a talk, sometimes a few hundred people are there, sometimes just a few dozen people will be there. So if now Maharaj has worked for decades in India to build a vibrant community here, and he could be resting on his laurels, and here devotees from all over the country will share Krishna Bhakti, bring people, and Maharaj can initiate them, and he can expand preaching. But Maharaj is not resting on his laurels. Maharaj, when I asked him about Western outreach, so he said, what is his inspiration or what is motivation? He says, Prabhupada has said several times, New York is the most important city in the world. And he says, I want to do something, some service to Prabhupada at the place which he considered so important. Now, practically speaking, Prabhupada spent a lot of time in Mumbai, and Maharaj has created a magnificent community in Mumbai. So what he did in Mumbai, now in some ways he's trying to recreate in the Bhakti Center. And in this way, actually, he is in many different ways trying to fulfill Srila Prabhupada's desires. Even if fulfilling that desires means he has to extend himself. He has to sacrifice. He has to be very. He has to, in one sense, start from the scratch, build a community from the bottom up, which he has done 30 years ago. Now he has to do it again. Of course, there are devotees in the Bhakti Center, and they're very dedicated, but it has happened over years of endeavor. And so that, not resting on one's laurels, just like Prabhupada in his old age went from India to America to preach in America. So Maharaj, after he has built this magnificent community in India, is now focusing on the West. And he's doing this because he just wants to create or establish a legacy for Srila Prabhupada in the Western world. And and of course, while doing this, he is using, as I said, using his spiritualized or purified instincts. He's doing many things which have not been done in the past in the moment. And because they've not been done in the past, there are some people, even from within the movement, who criticize. And Maharaj can just stop all this and he can avoid all that criticism. But he's ready to take that criticism even for Srila Prabhupada's, for spreading Srila Prabhupada's mission. So I'll conclude with this point that Maharaj told me that, what are the exact words? He said that something like, the world is such a place that the people for whom you are giving your life, now they will act in ways that will take your life. But that is the test of our service attitude. That when we are trying to serve, we're trying to serve Prabhupada's mission, we are trying to serve Krishna's mission. But sometimes those whom we are trying to serve, those on whose behalf we're actually trying to work. Now, of course, Maharaj is working for Srila Prabhupada, but he's working for the whole movement. But sometimes from within itself, that criticism will come. And he says, that is a test of our devotion. That is a test of our service attitude. Now, we are ready for criticism from the outside world because we are living according to different values. But sometimes criticism may come from inside also. Now, that is very painful. But that is the price we may have to pay. Now, this doesn't mean we deliberately become non-cooperative and we trigger criticism. That's not the point at all. The point is that if we are to reach out to people who have not been reached out before, then we may have to do things which have not been done before. Why? Because the world has changed. And there is no counterculture that we can reach out by a very confrontational approach. So we have to find ways in which we can reach out. There's one devotee who asked Maharaj, Prabhupada talked about boiling the milk. So Maharaj simply replied, where is the milk? First we have to get the milk, then we can think about boiling it, especially in the Western world. So yes, we want to have committed devotees, but first we need devotees. First we need devotionally interested people, devotionally inclined people. Then they become devotees, then we can have committed devotees. So there is a trajectory. And that trajectory is what has been, so the Western Outreach Center like Bhakti Center and the Indian Retreat Center like the Govardhan Eco Village, through that a trajectory is being created for many, many people to become elevated and enriched in their spiritual life. Now, of course, for most of us, we may not get the personal association of Maharaj because the Maharaj is doing so many services in so many different places. It's difficult for us to get association. But if we can just appreciate the dedication and we can take inspiration from that. And Maharaj has created a community of devotees whom he has trained and through whom we can get care, through whom we can get some guidance, some association, some inspiration. And rather than lamenting that we don't get the association of our spiritual master, we can think, how can I assist in the mission of the spiritual master? We don't want to burden the shoulder of the spiritual master. We want to shoulder the burden of the spiritual master. We don't want to burden the shoulder. I want your time. I want your time. I want your time. Yes, if we get it, it's wonderful. But if we don't, if we try to assist in the spiritual master's mission, wherever we are, if we try to assist in the spiritual master's mission, then we are actually shouldering the burden of the spiritual master. We are assisting. So now, wherever we are, how can we assist? Now, suppose if we are not in a project where Maharaj is directly active and Maharaj is directly preaching. So I have asked several devotees this question and they've all told me a similar answer. Maharaj said three things. He said, wherever you are, be Krishna conscious, be happy, and be cooperative with the local devotees. So if we do this, even if we are not assisting Maharaj directly in his projects, we are carrying out his instructions. We are assisting in the broader mission of Srila Prabhupada. And that mission is not just to spread the temples and distribute books. It is also to spread Krishna Bhakti in our hearts. So be Krishna conscious, be happy. Be Krishna conscious doesn't mean it has to be an austerity constantly. We do it in a way that is susukham. We find out ways in which we can be happy in Krishna consciousness. And then be cooperative with the local devotees. In that way, we all can shoulder the burden of the spiritual master. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke broadly on four themes. I started by talking about how, for me, the road to the heart is through the head. So with my head, how I've been trying to understand and appreciate Maharaj, I tried to speak that. So with respect to the journey home, talk about the inclusive and the exclusive and the inclusive glorification of Srila Prabhupada. So those who have already committed to Prabhupada, there are many, many books glorifying them. But those who have not, the number of books which can actually present Prabhupada's glories in a way that is not exclusive, that doesn't sound exclusivist or sectarian. There are not many books. So Maharaj's books is among the foremost in that book. And his purpose is to, as I said, you know, elevate, if people are not ready to elevate their consciousness, expand their consciousness. Let them appreciate other paths, even if they're not ready to take up that path. And then sometimes what happens is we think we have elevated our consciousness and we become narrow-minded and sectarian. So Maharaj is present, showing how spirituality can be shared in a non-sectarian way through his journey home. And then the Prabhupada that has often been overlooked in our movement is the Prabhupada that attracted Maharaj's heart. And that is the Prabhupada of the Markine Bhagavad Dharma, who is humble, who is surrendered, who is prayerful. So the confrontational Prabhupada is not the only Prabhupada. Prabhupada had many different dimensions to him. And then I talked about the second is the Bhaktivedanta Hospital. So Maharaj is showing how devotion and compassion can be integrated in a way that is healthy. That is like a healthy alternative to the way it is done by the Advaitins and what Srila Prabhupada criticized. So it required courage for him to do that in the face of opposition. But now he's demonstrated a living project where there's also improvised Varnashram in today's world. And why should we leave humanitarian compassion to other organizations? They don't have a monopoly on that. So that is, and then the third I talked about, Western outreach, that is Maharaj is not resting on his laurels, but doing what it takes to reach out to Western audiences. And then to avoid, so taking Krishna consciousness beyond the institutional reach and the institutional boundaries, that he's doing by presenting himself as first as a spiritual seeker, in journey home, and then as not a spiritual teacher in the high up sense, but as a person who has experience of bhakti yoga for many years, sharing it that way. So the whole mood is not to teach philosophy, but to share wisdom that adds values in people's life. And then we talked about meeting people where they are at and how Prabhupada was so accepting of George Harrison. That some people, we open the door to Krishna for them, and for some people, they open the door for us to take Krishna to others. If you try to force them to come to Krishna, they will go away. So there are many people, Prabhupada was like that with the life members. He just accepted them where they are. And so he engaged them in service, even if they were not ready to rise in devotion. So that is what is being done to a substantial degree to the Western outreach. And then lastly, our Govardhan Eco Village talked about two things. First is that, you know, whatever the cultural current that has to be tapped if you want to be effective. So Prabhupada in the West tapped the countercultural current by his confrontational presentation. In India, he tapped the cultural nationalism current by inspiring Indians to contribute to his mission. So today there is the environmental awareness current, and that can be tapped through the Govardhan Eco Village. And not just that, basically many ways in which people can experience Krishna and get the association of devotees in a way that is non-threatening, that doesn't seem intrusive to them. So that is the expertise of creating the center, creating this vision or manifesting this vision. And then lastly, I talked about how, you know, we may not get the association of Maharaj, but we can assist, we can shoulder his burden by being Krishna conscious, being happy, and by cooperating with the devotees wherever they are, cooperating with the local authority, local devotee authorities wherever they are, where we are. So thank you very much. His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki jai.
Amazing. Thank you very, very much, Prabhu. This was super brilliant analysis that you did. It was really amazing. And we know now how you have been so, in one sense, closely serving in all these four quarters, assisting in the Journey Home, Journey Within project, served so much in Bhaktivedanta Hospital, and now with the Western Outreach and TEV. So many seminars you've participated in TV and you did for TV and helping in so many ways. It was really very, very inspirational talk, and at least broaden our wisdom and many doubts which people get, because we hear so much about these things which you clarified so wonderfully. Very, very grateful to you, Prabhu. Thank you very, very much. And you're truly assisting Gurudev in shouldering the burden in all these different aspects. That's very, very, very inspirational for me personally. Thank you, Prabhu. Pranavanand Prabhu, do we have some time for questions?
Yes, Prabhu. If Prabhuji is okay, then Prabhuji can take some questions.
Yes.
And before that, I just want to make one announcement, Prabhu, that many devotees are asking for the previous recordings as well as Prabhuji's recording today, as they could not hear because of different reasons. So I'm just sending the group link in the chat box. Devotees can use this link to join the WhatsApp group, His Holiness Radhanath Swami Nectar, so that they can get the previous recordings and also the future information. For previous recordings, they can just miss it.
ओके ते तुम्हाला द्यायचं होतं ते कपडा आणि कसं होतं ते शोधून घ्यायचं माझ्या घरी ठेवलं आहे म्हणजे जाणार
आहे. वी हॅव टाइम, वी हॅव टाइम फॉर क्वेश्चन्स, कॅन वी टेक?
यस 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 श्योरली.
यस इफ समबडी हॅज क्वेश्चन दे कॅन आस्क डायरेक्टली. प्रणवानंद यू कॅन फॅसिलिटेट अनम्यूटिंग. Some devotees have sent me on chat also, but I'm not able to access my chat. So if they want to read out, they can read out, please.
Yeah, I can see. Maybe I can read out. I can myself. Should I read out?
For sure, bro.
Okay.
Yes, bro, please.
So thank you, Venkat Bhatt Prabhu, for your kind words. No, happy to be of service. And what do you see the question by what... What do you see as the reason for Westerners accepting Prabhupada as authority, despite the very happy movement being a rejection of authority? But it is not the case in recent times, as people don't wish to have authorities. You know, there are many different ways of understanding this. I've also pondered this. At that time, it was not so much just a rejection of authority as a rejection of inauthenticity, where people saw that the Vietnam War, which was going on, that was supposed to be for fighting communism, but that was basically, they thought that it was just to fill the coffers of the military industrial complex, as a former American president had spoken. So they saw religious teachers, they seemed to be more interested in position and power than in actual spirituality. So basically, it was inauthenticity which led to the rebellion against authority. And when they saw authenticity in Srila Prabhupada, then they committed themselves, they surrendered themselves. So ultimately, nobody can, everybody wants guidance, but they want somebody whom they can trust. So, and for whatever reasons, they didn't find anyone trustworthy at that time. And when they found Srila Prabhupada, who was so selfless, so concerned, so compassionate, so trustworthy, that they were ready to give their life to him. Now, of course, Srila Prabhupada's presentation of Krishna Bhakti was also, as I said, very adventurous. So, very attractive. And he engaged the passion of the devotees over there. He gave them adventurous missions. Travel across the world, pick up a country and go and deliver that country. So, Prabhupada created book distribution. So, basically, when they found authenticity, they were ready to accept. They were ready to surrender. And now, in today's world also, if people find authenticity, yes, even now, they will commit. But the difference is that in 50 years or 40 years, if you consider 1960s, people who grew up, they, at that time, as compared to now, still there was a structure of authority. So people grew up in a culture where they accepted authority. Say, when many of the Prabhupada disciples, when the hippies, when they were growing up as kids, they had parental authority, they had teacher's authority. And they grew up in a culture where they accepted authority up to a particular time. Then they came in their teens and then their youth and they rejected the authority. But the idea of accepting authority was very much a part of the culture. However, they themselves found the authority, when they felt that the authority was not trustworthy, they rejected it. But the overall orientation to accept authority was a part of the culture at that time. But since then, 50 years down the line, the culture has become much more egalitarian. So even in homes, parents can't be too authoritative with their children. The teachers can't be too authoritative with their students. So the overall culture, it's the idea of accepting authority or submitting to authority is not there in mainstream society itself in today's world. And that's why accepting any authority is difficult for people. So that orientation, that training, that upbringing of accepting authority, submitting to authority, that is lacking. And that's why in the case of Srila Prabhupada, how it was, yeah, that upbringing was there, but that upbringing was rejected on seeing inauthenticity. And then that upbringing was acted upon, was when they saw authenticity in Srila Prabhupada. But in today's world, there is no upbringing like that at all. The broad culture doesn't really accept authority. So what was never there in the upbringing, that has to be slowly cultivated. And that is very difficult. So one general principle in approaching today's people is that there is no authority that can be assumed. Every single bit of authority has to be earned, if at all we have any authority. And authority is something which has to be earned with great effort, and it can be lost very easily. Authority, credibility can be lost very easily by even a slight little bit of indiscreet, inappropriate, or inauthentic behavior. Yes. Thank you, Ramasimha Prabhu. Yes, if we can all feel closer to Maharaj and imbibe his mood, yes, not only we can make our movement broader, but we can actually raise the consciousness of the world also. Okay. So we see that sometimes Western, this is Himangi Gopi Mati asking that we see Western people are ready to accept spirituality and philosophy, but they are skeptical toward Indian culture. What could be useful for overcoming this issue with culture? See, there are two different things in my understanding. See, there is cultural curiosity and there is cultural commitment. There is a lot of cultural curiosity in the Western world. There's a whole idea of multiculturalism, and people travel to different parts of the world because they want to see how other people live, what is their culture. Now, when I had the service of taking a group of Western devotees to Vrindavan and some other places. So at that time, I was a little apprehensive about telling stories of Krishna, which involves some kind of miracle, which may seem very far-fetched to people. So I was trying to present things philosophically. But then they wanted to know, what are the stories? What is the legend? What is the legend behind this place? What is the actual significance of this place? And they were not really, they were not hearing those stories with a skeptical attitude. This doesn't make sense. How can somebody lift up a whole hill like that? That question didn't come. They were interested. They were there as out of, we could say out of, many of them were out of there out of cultural curiosity. And they were interested. Okay. This is what the story you believe. This is why you do this. Okay. Not that we are saying you have to believe it. And they're not even considering whether I believe it or not. They're just trying to understand. Okay. What do you believe? So if it's cultural curiosity, people are very interested in that. And in fact, Indradyumna Maharaj has been very successful in channeling this cultural curiosity. So when he has this festival of India, people come and wear Indian clothes. They have these gopi dots that they eat Indian food. They see Indian music being played and they enjoy it. The problem is that there is cultural curiosity, which is a very great draw. We can attract a lot of people because they have cultural curiosity. But unfortunately, we don't keep much gap between cultural curiosity and cultural commitment. That means, now you start wearing these clothes. Now you start eating this food. Now you start chanting this mantra. No. Now, if you see in Govardhan Eco Village, there is no concealment of the culture. But just because Western people are coming doesn't mean that the devotees stop wearing saffron or the devotee lady stop wearing saris. So, no, our bhakti goes on as it is. Of course, we are not preachy over here, but in general, nobody is preachy in the Govardhan Eco Village. So people are interested in the culture. Oh, this is how you live. This is how you dress. So cultural curiosity is there. But the problem is when we start demanding cultural commitment from people, that if you want to become spiritual, you have to wear this kind of dress. You have to do this. That's when the problem comes up. So if we tap cultural curiosity, we can attract people. But if we insist on cultural commitment, we alienate people. So now where the problem comes up is some devotees start thinking that if you want to become spiritual, you have to adopt this culture. There is, there is a conversation of Srila Prabhupada with Allen Ginsberg. And there is a part of it in the book, The Hare Krishna Explosion. And there's the unabridged conversation in the Vedabase. And Maharaj told me that anyone who wants to do Western outreach, they should read this conversation. Allen Ginsberg starts by this point itself. He says, Swamiji, your movement is not likely to spread very far, much in the West. He said, Prabhupada said, why? He says, because you appear too sectarian. So Prabhupada says, no, we are universal. And then he says the three main things. He says, your food is sectarian, your food is Indian, your mantras are Sanskrit, they are from a different language, you dress in a different way. And Prabhupada says, you can chant any names of God. You don't have to dress in this way. You can dress in a decent, modest, respectable way. And you can offer any food to Krishna. So Prabhupada is very inclusive in his presentation over there. Now Prabhupada himself always wore traditional dresses, and for his committed disciples, they also wore traditional dresses. But did he insist that as integral part of Krishna bhakti for everyone? Well, he did not. So we could say that if you have a pendulum, there are two extremes. One extreme is to insist on the culture by saying that this is the only way you can become spiritual. And to say this is not just Indian culture, this is not just Indian culture, this is spiritual culture. So that we could say is one extreme or not just this is spiritual culture, this is the only spiritual culture. This is the only culture that you need to adopt to become spiritual. This is the only food you have to eat. This is the only culture dress you have to wear. That is one extreme. And that is definitely going to alienate people. But the other extreme is that we completely minimize and criticize things, saying this is Indian culture. And this has got nothing to do with spirituality. No, we don't need that. This is a culture through which the spirituality has been preserved for many, 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 many generations. We could say many millennia, in fact. And we don't need to minimize or trivialize that culture. Certainly, we don't need to demonize that culture. Like any culture that is practiced in the material world, there are faults in it. And those faults need to be recognized. They need to be addressed. So we don't have to insist on the culture, but we don't have to conceal the culture and certainly not criticize the culture. So cultural curiosity can be channeled, and then spiritual commitment has to be facilitated. Whether the spiritual commitment has to be accompanied by cultural commitment in terms of, say, adopting a particular culture, that is something which every Western outreach center's leaders will have to negotiate. And then they have to decide that. So I sometimes feel that it is we who have made the cultural issue bigger than it needs to be, either by insisting that we have to follow it or by insisting that there is nothing spiritual about it. No, we can follow our culture and we can present spirituality. And people, if they want to adopt the culture, wonderful. If they don't want to adopt the culture, but if they want to adopt the spirituality, that's also wonderful. I hope that answers the question. Thank you. Well, can we substantiate that Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur served the poor, Prabhupada also served? Well, what about Prabhupada's Food for Life program? That is a very powerful program. And there was, somehow what has happened in our movement is that there are quotes of Prabhupada which depict him in a particular way. They have become widely propagated. And there are other quotes of Prabhupada which have been very downplayed. So there was a famine in one part of the country. I can find that quote. Let me see if I can find it right away. So Prabhupada says, let us distribute prasad extensively over here and we will win the hearts of people by distributing prasad. So Prabhupada, what is he talking about there? During a famine, he's not just saying we'll go around there and chant Hare Krishna and we'll make rain come. He's saying distribute prasad. So we'll win the hearts of people. So Prabhupada is actually much bigger than our conceptions of Srila Prabhupada. And often we may have a conception of Prabhupada as being in a particular way, but Prabhupada has spoken so many things. Prabhupada has done so many things in so many different contexts. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Viraj Prabhu. There are many comments. I'm happy that I can't address all of them, but thank you for your comments. There are lots of questions also. How can we be broad-minded in understanding different moods and different dispositions of devotees in service of the movement? That's difficult. So, when there are some leaders who were criticizing Maharaj very severely for some of the things that he was doing. So one of our senior godbrother asked Maharaj, is that particular leader, is he envious? Maharaj said, no, not envious, but narrow-minded. Now, what does that mean? That means if I talk about the expansion of consciousness and elevation of consciousness. So that this is the only way to elevate the consciousness. They may be very spiritually, in one sense, they may be spiritually committed, devoted, but they have a very narrow vision about how spirituality is to be practiced. So, you know, every movement will have conservatives and every movement will have liberals. And that is an ongoing tension in every movement. So what to speak of every movement? I'm a writer and I study the English language. In English language, there are conservatives and liberals. That means liberals are those who want to, yeah, there are new words that are coming in circulation, the spoken word, let's bring it in the written word. There are new ways of speaking, let's bring it, adapt the grammar accordingly. And conservatives say, no, this is the way it has been, and we have to continue it. So, well, there is a tension between those who want to keep things as they are and those who want to see how things work and bring both together. So, you know, that is a tension which is there in every tradition, and we don't have to become disturbed just because this tension is there. Prabhupada's house is big enough for devotees with many different dispositions. And rather than worrying about devotees having different dispositions, you know, we can focus on associating with those devotees who inspire us and move in our spiritual life. And if specifically in our community, there are other devotees of different dispositions and whom we have to negotiate with, or we have to interact with regularly, then we can find out specifically how to address them. But otherwise, now if we start, say, surfing on the internet and getting exposed to many, many different devotees from widely varying dispositions, that might confuse us. Of course, it can also broaden our minds, but we have to see phalena parichayate. What is the result for us? If it's confusing us, then focus on where, through whom Krishna is inspiring us and move ahead accordingly. Don't worry too much about why there are differences. If it's not relevant to us, if it's relevant, then ask certain senior devotees and get a clearer understanding. But don't, you know, that there are differences in moods and dispositions. That's a very much a natural and expected part of any living tradition. So, I think it's already 9 o'clock, Prabhu. So, till what time should I? I don't want to extend too long.
Prabhu, if there are many questions, can we do another session just for the questions?
Yeah, I'll be happy to do that.
If you're okay, we can.
Yeah.
So, I think there will be many questions. It will be nice. Devotees can get some clarity, very important issues. So, maybe we can do is stop here, and in the next session you can give a topic, you can speak a little briefly and then open for questions.
Yes, you
is
know
that all right with you?
Yeah, that's a very good idea. Maybe I could broadly introduce the concept of conservatives and liberals, and sure, then we can have question answer questions on that.
Sure, Prabhuji, we will do that. So we will work out the dates with you and then communicate. Thank you very, very much, Prabhu. I'm sure everyone has greatly nourished, and their commitment to Gurudev and to his mission and the desire to shoulder him, assist him, the Prabhupada's mission, greatly improved by your wonderful clarity and dedication. Thank you very much, Prabhu.
Thank you very much. Happy to be of service. His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj ki jai.
Jai.
कृपा सिंधु पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः हरे कृष्ण